What I'm going to talk to you tonight about, obviously from the promotions you've been seeing and hearing for this event, is discerning media messages in an election year and beyond. I'm going to share with you a little bit of additional information that Camarella shared with you. It's actually been, I graduated from Central Michigan University in 1981, so I've been actually at this now for 35 years, not only Catholic radio and TV for 16, but in my hometown of Detroit, I was an anchorwoman and a reporter and a radio personality, a newspaper writer for many, many years. And I know this is when you say, oh, but you look so young. It's actually olive oil of Olay, I tell people. But I'll share with you my own journey from secular anchor to media evangelist. And the just funny thing is that I never intended to do this. I thought I was going to die somewhere in a live shot on Detroit's southwest side covering a snowstorm or a murder, because I never wanted to be anything else but a reporter from the time the nuns put a microphone in my hand in the third grade. Well, I did want to be a Rockette, but I was too short for that, so I gave that up fairly quickly. But my passion and my expertise in my work that I do now, and again, I've written almost 10 books, I have another one coming out next spring, is helping people deal with the culture. And you know why? Because the culture affected me greatly. To the point where when I went to school, because I was such a radical feminist and I was so into my career, that I left God on the cutting room floor. And by the time at the end of my freshman year in college, I was no longer attending Mass, wasn't paying any attention to God, I thought everything was going great. Did get married to a wonderful Catholic man who's now a deacon, which is another miracle, and we just celebrated 33 years of marriage. Praise be Jesus Christ, that's amazing. But I allowed the culture to seep into my life so much that it almost cost me my marriage and, more importantly, my soul. And what I realized was not only was I accepting all of the messages from the culture, but as someone who was in the secular media before coming back to the church, I had a radical reversion, and I'll tell you a little bit of that story as we go along, but I was putting out a lot of the lies that the media are just doing beyond reason anymore. And it really breaks my heart as someone who studied journalism. I have a journalism degree. I had internships in college. I was very determined to go out there and make a difference and to look at the industry at what's happened. It's no longer journalism for the most part. There are still a few good people out there. It's becoming fewer and far between. I still have some very good friends who are really trying to do their jobs in the secular media. But unfortunately, and we've seen it so badly in this election, just over the top. Now, I hope you'll agree with me. A couple of things. First of all, we're not going to be talking about, we don't endorse candidates, we don't tell you for whom to vote, the church doesn't do that. The church is charged to educate and teach about the issues. We don't do that on Catholic radio. We're not allowed to endorse a candidate. We don't, but we do talk about the issues. But I think you would agree with me that if we are to be educated voters, following what the church tells us, whether we're looking at living the gospel of life or faithful citizenship or any of the great documents we have on this in the church, that we have to have accurate information in order to make a decision, correct? Would you agree with that? And I'm sure that you all get that right now you're not getting a lot of accurate information, but I think you'll be surprised in terms of how bad it is. There's an awful lot of research out there, not only stemming from the 80s and the 90s to back this up, but especially recently, and we're going to get into these studies tonight, and we're going to learn an awful lot about that. And the whole idea, especially as it pertains to the life issues, which are the core teachings of the church, which undergird everything, it's going to give you a good sense of when something is coming at you, when a message is coming at you, you'll be able to a little bit better discern the message so you can make that educated decision at the voting booth. And beyond that, when you're making, you know, we live our everyday lives, if we love the Lord, as we're called to do in the faith, if we have a relationship with Him, then our Catholic faith, our Christian faith, should not be just a factor in our lives, it should be everything. We're supposed to let our faith dictate what we do every single day. Every day we get up in the morning and we give that day to God. Otherwise, it's just a Sunday thing. I had somebody comment on my Facebook page the other day. I put up a beautiful letter from Archbishop Samuel Aquila, who's the Archbishop in Denver. Voting as a Catholic in 2016, really well written. Again, not telling people for whom to vote, but very clear in terms of the teachings and what Catholics need to look at. And some woman writes on my Facebook page, he should mind his own business. And I said, he is minding his bishop, he's in his business, he's an archbishop, and he has to teach. That's his job, he's a shepherd. And I wrote on the Facebook page very nicely. Now sometimes, because I'm 100% Italian, I have to write out my messages separately, what, you know, my Italian temper wants to say, and then delete that, and then go back and write something in a Christian way. I said, you know what, you probably wouldn't have a problem if he was talking about the environment or the poor, which, by the way, are prudential matters, not intrinsic evils, and we'll get into that discussion a little bit later. You probably wouldn't have a problem if he was talking about something with which you agreed. But because he hit a nerve, you're upset with the archbishop. Our shepherds, our priests, our pastors, our deacons are here to teach us and to help us make those educated decisions, not only at the polls, not only when it comes to voting, but also every day, and that's what we're going to talk about tonight. I think it's very prophetic, given all the issues that we're seeing and all the questions that are being raised about the media, especially during this crazy election, that our Holy Father offered his October prayer intentions for journalists, because, oh boy, do we need them, let me tell you. He's asking that their work would always be motivated. Pray for journalists that their work would always be motivated by strong ethics and a respect for the truth. And unfortunately, especially here in the United States, that's not happening. Now, a little background on where you can find me. I do have a radio program Monday through Friday, which is syndicated through the EWTN, Global Catholic Radio Network. That stands for Eternal Word TV Network, but they also have, obviously, a radio network. And it's carried on The Rock here in Cleveland, which is AM 1260. I'm also carried in the Canton area, Living Bread Radio. And then it's produced by both EWTN and Ave Maria Radio, which is my home base back in Michigan. And Sirius Radio 130, you can hear the second hour of my program, Sirius Radio 130 at 9 a.m. So it's a two-hour show. The first hour is Midwest in Ohio, Indiana, and Michigan. The second hour is across the country on 500 affiliates and around the world. Then I'm also on EWTN television twice a week, Wednesday nights at 11 Eastern on the Catholic View for Women, and Friday mornings it's repeated at 10:30 every week. Catholic View for Women is a Catholic version of programs like The View, but we got tired of what we were seeing in women's talk shows, and we decided to do one from a truly Catholic perspective, and that's a Catholic View for Women. Some really good sources, resources for voting that I've collected and put on my homepage, and my business cards are out there, so all this information, if you don't have to write it down, it's on my website. You can just go to teresatomeo.com, and I've collected a number of really good resources, church documents, and different articles and videos and interviews that'll help you as you go to the polls this November, and again, I hope beyond. All right, here's our agenda. I have a lot of information I want to give to you in addition to a little bit of my story. Now, don't panic. I mean, I am 57 years old, but I won't keep you here to tell you the whole story. We'll be here until next October, but I'll share a little bit of my testimony and why I'm doing what I'm doing now. First, we're going to review some questions for consideration. Then we're going to talk about rising above the noise and Father's beautiful prayer, talking about the importance of being able to hear God above all the noise. Isn't it beautiful to walk into the sanctuary and just to hear the peace and quiet and just to sit? It amazes me everywhere we go, so much noise. And I travel all the time. And when I'm in the airport, I watch people and there's the monitors and everybody's got their iPads and they have their earplugs in. Noise, noise, noise. If there's too much noise, we won't be able to hear the Lord. Our next segment, never let the facts get in the way of a good story. What the media aren't telling us. We're going to look at several different reports that have come out regarding media bias and how many issues that we're concerned about as Christians are either ignored or greatly twisted, minimized, pushed out, and it's very important for us to understand this, especially in Respect Life Month. And you talk about God having a sense of humor. I was a pro-choice for a very long time. Of course, I thought I knew so much about what the Catholic Church taught. I still called myself Catholic, even though I never cracked open the catechism until I had my reversion. And when God started to change my heart on this issue, I was so overwhelmed by the beauty of the teaching and the dignity of women that's tied into the life teachings. And I thought, wow, where have I been? I could have had a V8, right? So it's very important for us to understand that when the media aren't covering these issues, we may think, as I did for many years, that they're not all that important. Now with God's sense of humor, what does he have me doing? My husband is a sidewalk counselor at the abortion facilities on the infamous 8 Mile in Detroit. I'm very involved in the pro-life movement across the country, work very closely with Priests for Life and Silent No More, which is a beautiful ministry that works with post-abortive women and men. And I cover the March for Life every year in Washington. So you talk about the Lord having a sense of humor. At one point in my radio career, I was even doing editorials on the air promoting abortion. Brothers and sisters, I should have been struck down by lightning a gazillion times, but God is merciful. And who would have thunk that this former, extremely radical woman would be a Catholic talk show host married to a deacon? Go figure. If God can change us and save my marriage, if he can change me, if he can change my husband, who was also a fallen away Catholic, and now he's a deacon, and I'm a Catholic talk show host, praise God, especially in this year of mercy. So Newsgate 2016, money and the media, and then we're going to take a look at a huge case of media deception. Katie Couric now being sued for $12 million because of that. For the Catholic brothers and sisters here tonight, we're going to review what the church says about our conscience. What does that mean? We toss that around, and I tossed that around for years. Oh, my conscience says this, I think that. But I didn't know what it meant to have a well-formed conscience. I just thought, I think about it. I read a few newspaper headlines. Then I make my opinion. But there's a big difference between opinion and conscience. And even though I'm sure many of you realize that, it's always good to go over and review what the church gives us. I find it very helpful to be reflective and go back to make sure I'm following the important steps and the guidance that the church gives us in this area. Then we're going to talk about code language and the Christian voter, understanding the spin. Different words that are out there that are all about deflection, deception, projection, to make us think the opposite of what is really going on. And once you are tuned into it, you're going to be very, very perceptive and realize how they're trying to sell you a bill of goods. And then we're going to have an action plan for the election year and beyond. And then we're going to have some encouraging words, because I'm going to give you a lot of information, and I don't want you to ever feel discouraged, because that's the devil's greatest tool. If he can discourage us and think that we don't matter, that the gospel doesn't matter, that Jesus doesn't matter, then he's won. But you know what? I've read the Bible. I've been in Bible study for a long time. Guess what? We win in the end. Woohoo! Get excited. We win. It's a good thing. And by the way, if we are persecuted or martyred, if we're martyred, we go straight to heaven, no purgatory. I'm liking that. What do you think? Although I want to be one of those with just cut my head off. I'm not like, you know, San Sebastian, or who was it, San Lorenzo, who's the patron saint of cooks. Father, you probably know this because you're a chef. When he was being grilled, he said, turn me over, I'm done on this side, you know. Tradition says that, but I want it done quickly. But anyway. All right, so our questions for reflection, let's start with that. And maybe just think about this as we go along in the presentation. And this was so huge in my life. I had been totally sucked in by the culture and by the messages. And I basically sacrificed, as I said, everything for my career. Because that's what we were told when we were in college in the 70s and the 80s, especially as a woman in a very competitive field as broadcasting. You have to work weekends, you have to work nights, you have to miss holidays, you have to do this. Okay, fine, I get that. Everybody has to work hard. But it was over the top, and as I said, it almost cost me my marriage, and especially, more importantly, my soul. So how much impact has the culture had on our relationship with God, our views on the hot-button issues, which, by the way, if you think about all the discussion and all the attacks on the church, they all boil down to one topic, sex. Nobody complains if the Pope is talking about the environment or feeding the poor, but when it comes to the issues, those hot button issues regarding sexuality, everybody says the church is so backward. And yet, if you look at the evidence, and this is where my journalism degree comes in, and I did so much research, and this is when, again, I fell head over heels in love with the church, also because the church teaching saved my life. But if you look at the evidence of all the sexually transmitted diseases that are at epidemic proportions, if you look at the breakdown of the family, if you look at the fallout from abortion in terms of women who are struggling, men now, all the connections between abortion and depression and breast cancer, you know, the church is amazing. The church is a fullness of truth. All that truth comes from God. So we can see that truth even if we don't, and I'll quote scripture and church teaching all day long because I'm just crazy about the Lord and I love what the church gives us. But truth is truth. It does not change, it does not go away. And all this evidence of the fallout, the things that we're seeing, is when we go and turn our backs on God. And I experience that. And so I'm not coming at this, any of the talks I give, any of the books I write, brothers and sisters, I am not coming at this from you're going to hell in a handbasket or this or that. I am coming from a place of a woman who was very wounded and who was very lost. But by the world standards, I had everything. I had the career, I had the money, I had and still have, thank you Jesus, the good-looking husband. On the outside, we were the it couple, we looked like we had it all, but on the inside, we were breaking because everything was about the money and the career. So I know the beauty of the church, and I also know people who struggle, and that's okay because I struggle. But we have to work through that, and we have to trust. If we really believe Jesus who he is who he is, and for Catholics, that means body, blood, soul, divinity of the Eucharist. If we say we want the Eucharist and we trust the church to give us the teachings on the sacraments and say, yes, I agree with you on that. This is what I did. Yeah, I want the Eucharist. Oh, yeah. I want those sacraments and I want reconciliation. But all this other stuff, you know I know better. And I didn't. And I don't. Father knows best and Mother knows best, as in God the Father and Holy Mother Church. So how much impact has a culture had on our relationship with God, our views on these hot-button issues, and our relationship with the church? How much impact, and this is a big one that I'm seeing every day in emails with this election and also on Facebook, how much impact is the culture along with personal feelings and emotions impacting my voting decisions? Yesterday on my program, I interviewed Father Tapaholchik, who's with the National Catholic Bioethics Center, and he's an expert on the life issues, doing a lot of work right now on this big push in our country for euthanasia. And he said he's seeing the same thing where Catholics and other Christians, but I'm talking about my particular Catholic audience, are pulling out of this election because they don't like the main candidates, the presidential candidates. Now, certainly we can understand that because it's frustrating, and this has been one of the dirtiest, nastiest campaigns we've ever seen. But given what is at stake, and given our responsibility, what our church teaches us, we can't just say, I don't like it, my feelings tell me this. You know what? It's not about our feelings. It's about a much bigger picture that we're all a part of, and that we will be held responsible if we don't take this seriously, because there's no excuse with all the guidelines the church gives us in this area. And so we pull back and we look at the platforms, we look at the big issues, and then we make our decisions. So how much impact is this having on our decisions, our emotions? What type of efforts, and this is one of them tonight, you're here, so obviously you care. You wouldn't be out here on a rainy, chilly night if you didn't care about this issue, if you didn't care about this election, if you didn't care about your faith. So what type of efforts are we taking to be a well-informed voter? Do I examine my media habits on a regular basis? That was a biggie for me. What are we taking in? How much are we allowing ourselves to be influenced, whether it's by news channels or films or, God forbid, pornography or things like that? Because that can affect the way we think and the way we act and the way we live. And then are we willing to make some changes, if necessary, in our media habits? And I kind of like to use this list, even for myself, as an examination of conscience to really think about these things. And sometimes, you know, it's, look, and I'm in the media, I'm on radio and TV, so the media aren't all bad. They're not intrinsically evil of themselves. It's what we do with them and how we use them. And the church has a whole beautiful body of teaching on proper media usage. But sometimes, you know, it's just really good to just have complete silence and just to sit in the silence, and maybe God will speak to us in that silence, just to turn off all the noise and give ourselves some peace, just to have some peace of mind. Last year, In the middle of the year, I had a very bad case of laryngitis to the point where I actually damaged my vocal cords. And I had to literally be silent. I could not talk on the phone. I could not say anything. My husband thought it was the greatest 6 weeks of his life. He was like, yay! And literally, our relationship was, you know, texting and writing notes. And I couldn't go on the air, so people were filling in for me, and I had, you know, running rerun after rerun, because my voice specialist told me, he said, I don't know if you'll ever get your voice back the way you had it before. I don't know. But you need to sit in silence, complete silence. And so in addition to not talking, I also use that time as a mini retreat. And I talk about this in my book, Saints, which came out on the Saints, which came out earlier in May. And it was such a beautiful, reflective time for me, just to sit and be with the Lord every day. And I took several books along with my daily devotionals, which I do. I read scripture every day and follow along with the church teachings or the church readings. And I'll tell you what, the Lord spoke to me and my patron saint, St. Teresa of Avila, whom I was named after. We just celebrated her feast day last Saturday. And it was so beautiful to have that silence. And I think all of us are so used to, even me, because I have to keep up on what's happening in the world. So used to turning on that TV or turning on that news station to make sure I know what's going on and getting on the wire service and writing my newscast for the show every day. But just to be still and know that He is God. Oops. There we go. John 10:27, my sheep hear my voice. I know them and they follow me. We have to have that silence in our lives if we are going to hear the Lord and be able to listen to His instruction. One of my favorite teachers of the day is Benedict XVI, and he said, we can only have faith in the risen one if we have encountered Him. Our Protestant brothers and sisters have a beautiful way of saying this. They say this personal relationship with the Lord Jesus. Have we encountered Him in that personal way? We can only encounter Him by following Him. Only if both things are true of us can we bear witness to Him and carry His light into the world. This tonight, brothers and sisters, is also about evangelizing. All of us, not just Father, not just me, because God gave me a platform, not just my husband or sister so-and-so or bishop so-and-so. By virtue of our baptism, our faith tells us we are all called to evangelize. But that could look very different for every one of us. It doesn't mean you have to stand on the street corner and pass out, you know, Bibles or catechisms. It just may be, and I think the most important thing we do to evangelize is to live out our faith joyfully. And to think of the word joy as an acronym, Jesus first, others second, yourself last. We have a saying in Italian called da fungia, which means mushroom. And my father used to tell me growing up, no fungia face. Our Holy Father, Pope Francis, says no pickled peppered Christians. So in other words, we have to be joyful. That's one of the best ways to witness. I mean, who wants to follow a Catholic who doesn't enjoy their faith? That's no fun. It's fun being a Christian. It's fun being Catholic. We do pilgrimages all the time, and I experience this with several different groups and priests that come along as our spiritual directors. And there's one amazing priest from Lincoln, Nebraska, Father Scott Courtney. And after every Mass, he has us, we could have hundreds of people in a church, wherever at, the Holy Land, Italy, wherever, and he makes the church or the church group stand up and say, I love being Catholic. And everybody looks around, they're like, oh, wow, they're really happy Christians. So to be joyful is one of the best ways to witness to our faith. This quote from Benedict XVI is actually on the cover of my very first book, Noise. Simply put, we are no longer able to hear God. There are too many frequencies filling our ears. And you know what, brothers and sisters? This quote means so much to me because in order for God to get my attention, He had to drag me kicking and screaming from the broadcast media for a time. The most painful thing I went through professionally was being fired overnight from a top TV position in Detroit. I went from being the lead story on the evening news the night before. The next day I walked in, was marched into the general manager's office with my news director, and they said, your contract's up in a month. Nice knowing you. We're not renewing your contract. Here's your severance check. See you later. I was fired overnight, literally. along with one of the anchormen and several other reporters, because the ratings were down and they were revamping, which often happens in the news business. They change on-air personalities like they change underwear and ties. I was aware of that, but I was so into myself and my career that I never thought in a million years they would fire me. Now, at that point in my life, I was far away from the church. This was in the early 90s. Still called myself Catholic, but barely went to Mass except maybe at Christmas and Easter. It was a painful thing, but it was the best thing that ever happened to me, because I was forced into silence, basically, away from the newsroom, away from the hustle and bustle, for 6 months. And I had several come to Jesus moments that made me realize that I was living my life very badly. And that's not easy, to look yourself in the mirror. But when I finally was all by myself and looked at myself in the mirror, I didn't like what I saw. My husband had been back in the church for about a year, and that's when I decided, you know, maybe this Catholic thing that I grew up with, 8 years of Catholic school, really good, solid education, although I ignored most of it after I graduated from grade school in 1973, maybe I should go back to that. I think a church that's been around for 2,000 years might know something. Go figure. But I had to be silenced, taken out of that atmosphere in order to hear God's plan for me. So in order to discern properly all these messages that are coming at us, we do have to allow ourselves some quiet time with the Lord and ask him, Lord, help. This is so confusing. There's all these voices coming at me 24/7. All right, now we're going to get into some of the nitty-gritty in terms of what's happening with the media. And I just want to put up a disclaimer again that we're not about endorsing candidates or parties or anything. The research that's out there right now, and by the way, these are from secular sources, the studies and the sources, and you can find them yourself, and I'd be happy to send them to you, are not from people with any religious or political dog in the fight, okay? They are independent think tanks, or maybe people who are doing these investigations that don't have party affiliations. And right now what we're seeing, and we have been seeing this really for about 30 years, is the media leaning way, 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 way to the left. I mean, that was always the case, but now it's so blatant. As I said earlier, it's not even journalism. Let me give you one example from a friend of mine who works at a big daily paper. I'm not gonna tell you which one, because I promised that I would never reveal which paper, because I don't wanna get him in trouble. So again, as I said in the beginning of this presentation, we would agree, and we could even do this by a show of hands, regardless of where you stand politically, don't you agree that we as the public deserve accurate information and at least an attempt at objectivity when it comes to all stories, but especially during an election? Can I see a show of hands? We deserve the truth, right? All right, so this friend is an experienced journalist, an investigative reporter for a major news operation, and he listens to my show. And about a month ago, they had an editorial meeting at his newspaper, big newspaper, by the way. And the powers that be at this editorial meeting, the editor said, we are not going to, or are we under any obligation, to cover Donald Trump fairly or in a balanced manner. Because he's not a normal candidate. So therefore, because we don't think he's a normal candidate, we are under no obligation to cover him normally, as we would try to do with at least an attempt at objectivity and balance. That, my friends, is not journalism. That's propaganda. Okay? Now, I would say the same thing if it were the other way around for the candidate, because as journalists, now there's never anything as total objectivity. That's just humanly impossible, because we bring a little bit of baggage to the table whenever we, you know, go into a newsroom, because we are who we are. So some of that is to be expected. There's never 100% objectivity. But what is happening then at this newspaper is that they are determining who the normal candidate is. They are the barometer. Who died and put them in charge? Whether we like it or not, the people put forth these two candidates based on the votes. And so now this newspaper is going to make the determination as to how they're going to cover it. That's not fair. That's not even journalism. Again, that's propaganda. And if you're doing that, then you have a right to tell your readers or your viewers, because you're still coming off as a secular newspaper. Okay? Now, it's different If you have, let's say, a conservative talk show host, for example, let's say like a Rush Limbaugh or a Sean Hannity, they are, or a Dennis Prager, they are very open and they say, look, this is, you know, whom I support, or on the other side, maybe a Democratic person, right? Maybe someone on, you know, MSNBC who's out there saying, I am a Democrat and this is what I support. Look, they're allowed to do that. They identify, they write books, they do this, that. That's fine. They have a right to that. At Catholic Radio, we make no bones. We teach the Catholic faith. We support the magisterium. We're a pro-life radio and TV network. Bones about it. Okay, we don't, again, don't tell people how to vote, but we uphold the teachings. And here you have a major newspaper. And if it's going on at one major newspaper, and you'll see in this latest study, it's going on at a number of outlets, that's not fair. If you're subscribing to a newspaper, you deserve the truth. You deserve at least an attempt, for goodness sake, at accuracy and balance. All right, so Newsgate 2016 was an investigative report done by a woman by the name of Cheryl Atkinson. If you're not familiar with her, she is a former investigative reporter for CBS News. She was based in Washington. She left because she felt that she was pressured to cover stories a certain way and not in a fair and balanced manner. She came after Bernie Goldberg. You're probably familiar with him. He wrote the book Bias. He's written several books about media bias. And again, he's not a conservative. He describes himself as kind of middle of the road, more of a libertarian. And so Bernard Goldberg left, Atkinson did the same thing, and she started now her own investigative team, and she has a special program that appears on the Sinclair Broadcasting Network. And she is an award-winning investigative reporter. And so she studied just recently where the media are, and in particular in this election. And you can go to her website, which is simply CherylAtkinson.com, and you can find it. I'd be happy to send you the information. She said, regardless of who is your chosen or least favorite presidential candidate, independent minds should be concerned about the latest revelations in the news media's unseemly relationships with government and political actors. While there are many responsible journalists working today, inside documents and leaks have exposed serious lapses, constituting the most far-reaching scandal, and it is scandalous what's happening in our media today. The industry has known. And she calls it our very own Newsgate. She says, and this is very true, compromised reporting has always existed as a result of covert collaborations between reporters and political officials, both on the Democratic and Republican side. The most recent evidence, however, is heavy on Democratic ties due to the nature of available documents and leaks. Whether we realize it or not, they figured out how to exploit the media and use us to publish their propaganda. It implies a broad and growing trend that has seriously undermined the credibility of the news industry. And she repeats what I just told you. Opinion reporters and those who work for obviously ideological news groups are entitled to publish their beliefs, their, you know, propaganda, if you want to call it that. It's one matter to provide viewpoint journalism, okay? But it's quite another to act as any tool of interest, publishing narratives or talking points upon suggestion or demand without disclosing that we've done just that. So the players she mentioned, I don't have time to go into all of them, but I chose some big ones and I'm going to explain why. She says the following accounts come from Human Resources, Freedom of Information Act documents, and WikiLeaks emails. Obviously, this is just a small sampling of behind-the-scenes deals going on between reporters and their stories. So she talks about some pretty big guns were involved in this. Associated Press, New York Times, The Washington Post, LA Times, CNN, MSNBC, CNBC, Huffington Post, and more. And again, you can go to her website to get the full list. Now, just to give you an example, what she found with the Associated Press was the State Department considered AP reporters Matt Lee and Bradley Clapper friendlies, people that they felt they had a good enough relationship with to maybe push some stories on, and planned to place Hillary Clinton email stories with them and dictate the time of their release. The goal was to blunt the June 2015 news that Clinton had failed to provide Congress certain required emails. Clinton campaign press officer Nick Merrill coordinated directly with the State Department on the plan to use AP to, quote, lay this out before the Republican majority on the Benghazi committee so they have a chance to realize what they have and distort it. And a quote from the reporter, the contact was, it would be good to frame this and frankly to have it break tomorrow when we'll be likely close or in the midst of a Supreme Court decision taking over the news agendas. Moving on to CNN, the Clinton campaign emailed that CNN political producer Dan Merica and Clinton were basically courting each other. In an email, Democratic National Committee Chair Donna Brazile, then a CNN contributor, said she obtained an advanced presidential debate question, and this is being discussed right now, and passed it on to the Hillary campaign. So similar stories go on with the Los Angeles Times and New York Times and others. Now, the reason I put the AP up there and New York Times and some of these other different networks is especially for the AP and the New York Times, what a lot of people don't realize, and you really wouldn't have any way of knowing this unless you understood the insides of the way journalism works, the Associated Press is a news outlet of its own. But the Associated Press and the New York Times also have their own news services. So they feed media outlets around the country. So for example, a radio or TV station would subscribe to the AP because it would give them access to all kinds of audio or video bites or different stories that they don't have a full staff to cover. That's why they pay for a news service. At Ave Maria Radio, we pay for a news service. It's not AP, it's another one called Metro Source because AP is very expensive. And so basically what that gives me every day is an access to sound bites. So I could have access to bites from the debate last night. But therefore, I'm just one of thousands of reporters who are accessing information from a particular wire service. And so if this stuff is going on, this alleged collusion behind the scenes, it's not only affecting the stories that are put out by the AP, let's say on their website or on their individual newscasts, or the New York Times, who also has a news service. This is being put out and regurgitated over and over and over again by all kinds of media outlets, both print and broadcast. So the bias, and in many cases the lies, continue, absolutely continue over and over again, a drumbeat of misinformation, and we don't have accurate information or facts when we're trying to make a decision on something. That's not what the media are supposed to be about. We're supposed to put it out there and let you make a decision. This is a very interesting report that came out from the Center for Public Integrity, which is a non-Protestant group, okay? They describe themselves as nonprofit, nonpartisan investigative news organization. The headline which accompanied the report's release earlier this month is enough to really upset any of us, regardless of where we stand in the political realm, about how the mass media cover major issues, not only elections, but news in general. And given, again, how much politics, right, makes up news, even, you know, when we're not in an election year. So here's a headline on this main website, Center for Public Integrity. Journalists shower Hillary Clinton with campaign cash. Far few making contributions to Donald Trump, analysis shows. In all, people identified in federal campaign finance filings as journalists, reporters, news editors, or TV news anchors, as well as other donors known to be working in journalism, have combined to give more than or close to $400,000 to the presidential campaigns of both Clinton and Trump. Nearly all of that money, more than 96%, has benefited Clinton. About 430 people who work in journalism have through August combined to give about $382,000 to the nominee. About 50 contributors donated $14,000 to Trump. Now here's what else is very interesting. The people who donated to Clinton were mainly reporters for secular organizations. They didn't work for, let's say, The Patriot or, you know, a Fox News show, or work, you know, with Rush Limbaugh or something like that. They maybe, you know, were working in an entity, but they were mainly working as a news person. It may have been behind the scenes, but most of them are working in a news capacity, which is different than opinion. The folks who donated the money to Trump were pretty much conservative talk show hosts and folks affiliated with those types of shows. Now, in a perfect world, well, first of all, this used to be a no-no. When I was in the business and I left secular media 16 years ago, we could not contribute to political campaigns. And I still don't do that. I'm not even a registered Republican or Democrat. I don't register with either party because as a Catholic believer, I don't think either party fully represents me 100%. And I also always want to make sure, even though I'm now a Catholic journalist, that there could never ever be any possible even appearance of conflict of interest. So I don't donate to political campaigns. I do support pro-life causes and other, you know, there's certain charities that we support, but I don't support particular political candidates. So in a perfect world, it shouldn't matter because we are trained, or used to be trained in J school, journalism school, that we have to leave our feelings at the door. But now the media are telling us, as the case that I mentioned with my friend, the print journalist from that major paper, they are parading themselves as journalists, making us think they're covering it fairly. They think we're really stupid. They really think we're stupid. When they should be honest and say where they're coming from, okay? In a perfect world, we should be able to walk into the newsroom and leave our opinions. But we live in a fallen world and totally lost to objectivity right now. And it's an industry that really has lost its soul for the sake of not only propaganda and agenda, but of course, profit. The last couple of weeks, this election coverage has looked like nothing more than the cover of Inquirer magazine. Do you agree with that in many ways? All right, now this next story is just absolutely shocking. Even I was shocked by it, and I thought, okay, I've seen just about everything in my 35 plus years as a reporter. So Katie Couric, who's very well known for her work, and she was on the Today Show for years and did a lot of work with NBC and then anchored at CBS, was working with this team to produce this documentary on gun control, which was released in May, called Under the Gun. She sat down with a group from Virginia, Virginia Citizens Defense League. They are pro-NRA, pro-guns. And so the interview was part of this documentary to investigate gun owners and how they feel about laws and also people who have been victims of gun violence, which is a very good topic and a very important topic. So she sits down with these folks as part of the interview. And she asked them a question, what about background checks, which is a very fair and important question to ask in this debate. And she said, if we don't have really good background checks, how are we going to prevent guns from getting into the hands of the wrong people, such as criminals that may have been released or, let's say, God forbid, terrorists, right? Legitimate question comes up all the time in the discussion. Now, thanks be to God, this group was rolling audio on their interview. That they had a copy of the interview. So what this team did was at some point during this interview, when she had the group there sitting for this extended, 2 hours, whatever they were there for the interview with her, she said, if you could just sit quietly for about 20 seconds, we have to recalibrate the equipment, whatever the heck that means. I've done TV forever, I never heard that term. Recalibrate the equipment. Well, they don't know, they're not TV people. They're thinking, okay, well, you know, whatever, fine. So they sit there very politely, complete silence. However, what you see on the report is the silence. However, they answered that question about gun control for 4 to 6 minutes. They gave a very good, very strong answer in terms of legislation, in terms of laws, in terms of background checks. Do you really think, and this is where, again, they think we're stupid, do you really think an NRA group, with all the controversy and all the stories we've seen with gun violence, are going to sit in an interview with Katie Couric and not have an answer to the most basic question that reporters ask? I mean, really? Do we look like we just fell off the turnip truck and wear short pants? I guess so. So she removes that 6 minutes, 4 to 6 minutes of a pretty good answer. They take that out, and they take the 10 to 15 seconds of silence and replace it. So when you see the documentary, it looks like these people who knew their stuff had no answer. And they were just a bunch of dumb, crazy, redneck gun owners who had no idea about the legislative efforts regarding gun control. That is totally deceptive. What they did was they invented the news, because that did not happen. She had an answer. She just didn't like it. And so they sued. And they sued for $12 million. The suit was just filed last month. And I say, good for them. Because more people need to stand up and fight back for what's being done. But think about that. Replacing a legitimate answer with phony silence, making it appear as if these people didn't know what they were talking about. The documentary originally aired in May, and a lot of people complained about it. They thought it was very unbalanced anyway. But then to do that, and the producer actually said, well, we were just hoping that people would think about that question. Really? Sure, and I'm the new Queen of England. I mean, it's just ridiculous. They insult our intelligence. All right. Code language and the Christian voter, understanding the spin. One of the biggest areas where we see this, brothers and sisters, this is Respect Life Month, is in the area of life, or even in the area of sexuality. It actually is, and I don't know how many of you are familiar with The Rules for Radicals by Saul Alinsky, but EW Chan is running an excellent program on Saul Alinsky. And this is actually what is right from his handbook. You deflect, you project, you deceive, you marginalize. And that's exactly what's been happening to pro-life people forever. And it's getting even worse. Terms that you often hear associated with anybody even slightly right of center: controversial or radical. This is often seen, again, with pro-life legislation or ordinances. We've been seeing this a lot with the transgender bathroom issue. Okay? Here's an example. This is a story from the wire service that we use at Ave Maria Radio Metro Source. It's a story about North Carolina Governor Pat McCrory. And he is saying, you know what? I don't agree, and my citizens don't agree with this idea that we have to have all these transgender bathrooms. Okay? So this is a story that they put out about this. This is from earlier this summer. North Carolina Governor Pat McCrory is saying cities and states shouldn't try to play human resources directors in the private sector. And then you have a short soundbite from him. And it comes back. McCrory defended his state's bathroom bill on NBC's Meet the Press. The controversial law requires people to use bathrooms that correspond to their sex listed at birth and restricts cities' abilities to pass non-discrimination laws. Now think about that. That's controversial, having a man's bathroom and a woman's bathroom. What's controversial about that? The controversy is the other way around. But you put that word there, the adjectives, the adverbs, you throw them out all over the place and you keep repeating it. And people start feeling, oh gosh, I'm controversial, I can't say anything. And it happens all the time. Or else extremists, extreme right-wing extremism, labels terminology when discussing, again, people or groups who are socially conservative, especially when it comes to the pro-life teachings. And it's ironic because most of the pro-life surveys, and there was a Marist poll that came out in September, so the majority of Americans are pro-life, and even if they consider themselves pro-choice, they believe in at least some restrictions on abortion. And they are totally against partial birth abortion, which is not the case with particular candidates that are running right now. And most people don't even know that, thanks to Roe v. Wade, abortion is legal through 9 months in this country. Through 9 months. Most people don't know that there are 4,000 abortions a day. Most people don't know that abortion mills, the singular ones, are unregulated. And yet they throw out terms about reproductive health. Well, really, if you want to be reproductive and healthy, you should be having children. We're all about reproductive health. And if you're so concerned about reproductive health, why do pro-abortion politicians, both Republican and Democrat, why do they shut down investigating abortion mills? You know, you don't even have to be an OBGYN to do an abortion. You can be a podiatrist. And in California, you don't have to be a doctor of any kind. You can be a midwife. And it took a social media campaign to embarrass the media into covering the trial of Kermit Gosnell, one of the most notorious abortionists in the world. That was going on for years. So many women died, so many women were hurt, and from the top on down, and there was a Republican governor, by the way, if you think I'm just picking on Democrats, a Republican governor was in charge when all this was going on, most of it. And doctors from the ER were complaining to state officials about this guy. And nobody said anything because of the sacred cow of abortion. And so many people still don't even know about the Kermit Gosnell case. And last night, there was a big mistake about Planned Parenthood. Planned Parenthood does not do mammograms. They do not do mammograms. Cecile Richards, when she was testifying before Congress on the baby parts scandal, admitted, we don't do mammograms, but they say that they do. That's a lie. Because they want you to think they're doing so many wonderful things. Planned Parenthood is the number one abortion provider in the country, 300,000 abortions a year. Thanks very much to our tax dollars, they get 500 million of our tax dollars a year. And Cecile Richards makes over, the president of Planned Parenthood, over $100 million a year. These are the stories that don't get out. And so if you omit them, if you label pro-lifers as controversial, extreme, another big one is, of course, are you a progressive Catholic or are you a backward or a traditionalist Catholic? I had a reporter ask me that once. Thank God it was on the phone because I would have punched him. I said, I'm Catholic. There are some teachings in the church that may seem more liberal and may fall under one particular party, and there may be some other issues that fall elsewhere. But I try to follow my Catholic faith as best I can, okay? I don't look at myself as a Republican or Democrat. I look at myself as a Catholic. He didn't like that very much, so he didn't use the quotes that I gave him in the interview. Anyway, that's a whole other story. Another big phrase we've heard is the war on women. You know what? Another case of deflection and projection, because the real war on women is what's going on with the unregulated abortion industry, the fallout from the dangers of contraception. Another new study that came out from the Netherlands, they studied out how many thousands of women and showed a strong connection between the birth control pill and depression. There are countless studies that show a connection between the birth control pill and increased risk of breast cancer. On and on and on. And I knew none of this. And when I did an interview, which first started to open my eyes, I was way back in the 80s, or late 80s, when we were looking at welfare-funded abortions in Michigan and we were trying to get rid of them. And I had to, go figure, actually interview both sides of the story. Who knew? So I brought in someone from Michigan Right to Life and a spokesperson from NARAL, National Abortion Rights Action League, which is now called NARAL Pro-Choice America because they want to soften their title. And I started hearing from the person from Right to Life about unregulated abortion mills, how majority of women have abortions not because they think they have a choice, but because, God love them, they feel pressured, they don't feel like they have a choice. Maybe it's economic, maybe their boyfriend or a spouse, somebody's pressuring them to have an abortion. My husband is a sidewalk counselor, as I said, on 8 Mile. He's been doing this for years. And not once has he ever seen a woman walking in looking very relaxed going in for an abortion. God love them. The majority of them are going in because they feel like they don't have a choice. But all of a sudden, a few years ago, when the government came out with something called the HHS mandate, the Health and Human Services mandate, there was all of a sudden a war on women, and the Catholic Church was the ones pushing this out there. We were the ones who were, you know, waging this war on women. Why? Because, oh my goodness, the church didn't want to pay for insurance plans that included coverage for abortifacients, birth control, because it's against our faith, right? It's a core teaching. The church wasn't going around into the CVSs and the Walgreens and the Rite Aids pulling condoms and other birth control methods off the shelves. The church wasn't running into OBGYN's offices saying you can't prescribe the pill anymore. The church, the Catholic Church, which is still involved in a lawsuit with the government, by the way, a lot of people don't even know that, was just basically saying, look, we have a right under the Constitution of freedom of religion and we shouldn't have to pay for this. And because we were fighting it, we were accused of being involved in this war on women. Where were all these women who were supposedly so offended about the church not paying or covering their birth control before? We never heard about it. I never heard about it. And I'm in a family of liberals. My husband and I have three heads, and most of my family completely disagrees with me on the issues. And my sisters used birth control for years. I did for a while too, confessed it, came back to the church. But they never once mentioned anything about feeling that the church should, when hearing a story, have to pay for that. So this war on women. Pro-life people in the secular media are referred as anti-choice. Why is that so important in order to promote abortion? Because we're Americans and we like our choices. So if we're seen as anti-choice, we're bad. If we're seen as pro-choice, we're good. In the Associated Press style book, which is the rule book for grammar and editing for journalists, journalists are told to use the term anti-choice or anti-abortion versus pro-life. And then, of course, we have the silence and the omission regarding the fallout of the so-called sexual revolution versus the steady drumbeat of sexual promiscuity. I mentioned earlier breakdown of the family, sexually transmitted diseases at epidemic numbers, health and emotional issues related to abortion, lack of regulation and safety at freestanding abortion clinics, problems with Planned Parenthood, tax dollars, baby body parts investigations, zero, zip, nada coverage on the March for Life in Washington every year. We have between, and I know because I've been covering it for many years now, between 250 and 500,000 people that cover, that go to the March for Life from around the country and around the world. I'm there every year, standing in the freezing cold, doing live shots all day long. And you know what the media say? And usually we get about between, I'd say maybe 20 and maybe 50 tops protesters from the pro-abortion side at the Supreme Court. The media say both sides showed up at the Capitol today regarding the abortion issue. Well, technically, yeah, I guess that's right, but when you have almost 500,000 compared to 50, a little bit of a difference. Is that accurate reporting? No. All right. So anyway, these are just a few of the things to look for when you're reading something and to understand how they are trying to position those of us who care about these issues that are very important to us or should be very important to us as believers. And look, I was there, I used all this terminology, and part of the reason is I'm trying to get myself out of purgatory because I was so bad. I believed all this nonsense, I spewed it out, and I never even bothered to look until the Lord hit me on the head several times and woke me up. And I had to really get on my knees and beg for forgiveness and really, really, really embrace and help other people, especially women, embrace who they are in Christ and the beautiful teachings of the church that saved my life. And I know what it's like to be caught up in it, and I know what it's like to have these ideas that, well, nobody should tell me what to do with my body. We tell each other what to do with our bodies all the time. We have all kinds of laws that govern what we can and can't do with our bodies. And yet it's only when it comes to those particular sex issues or hot-button issues that people throw those lines out. We have laws against drunk driving, which means you can only drink a certain amount before you get behind the wheel. That affects our bodies. We have laws regarding illegal drugs. That affects our bodies. We have laws against assault, rape. Those are all decisions affecting how we use our bodies. So this is all the stuff that I had to sort through. It was like a big onion. And plus, you know, I'm half Calabrese and half Napolitan, so I got a lot of issues, all right? So it's like this big onion that I had to peel away, years of toxicity and not being open or even aware of what the church taught and the beauty of it. All right, another area that is so, so sad that's going on where we're being deceived, and it's really heartbreaking because people who are struggling, truly struggling with these issues, also need accurate information. And it breaks my heart because the church has such a beautiful teaching on helping brothers and sisters with same-sex attraction or gender confusion. We love all people. We don't condemn them. Our Holy Father has talked about accompanying them. But what we are told as Catholics is that we're wrong, and we have to insist that everybody should be able to jump in the free-for-all pool and do whatever they want. And that's not a good thing for any of us. We're all called to live chastely. Heterosexuals, our brothers and sisters who are struggling with these issues, whether it's same-sex attraction or gender confusion. But the church has a plan, and if we would open ourselves up to that plan, we would see that it's our best plan. And so what's happening in this area of the media is people who are struggling aren't getting the information about who they are created in the image and likeness of God and the reason for their design. So there is a lot of confusion. And again, just like with the other stories we were talking about, just put the information out there. What are we so afraid of? Just let people decide, but give them information and truth. We talk about mercy, but there is no mercy without truth. with the woman at the well, with all the encounters that Christ had with people who were in a difficult situation. For example, the woman at the well, which is one of my favorite gospel readings. Jesus met her right where she was at, but he didn't leave her there. He revealed the truth about who she was as his daughter, also the kind of life she was living, which was a woman of ill repute, right? Because she was living with a man that wasn't her husband, and she also told the Lord that she had five husbands previously. And then, of course, you have the adulterous woman. People always leave out the end of that verse where Jesus says, you know, does anyone condemn you? No, sir. Neither do I condemn you. And then what does he say to her? Go and sin no more. Kind of forget that part. And with the Samaritan woman, he talked to her. He drew her in. He identified who he was. He said to her, I am he. And what happens? She comes to the well with her water jug, very much a broken woman coming to the well at the middle of the day because it's hot and nobody is going to be around and she can avoid all the stares and the eyes and everything else. And she can get her jug of water and go back home and not have to worry about being talked about or made fun of. And if you read closely, not a word of scripture is ever wasted. If you read very closely, it says she left her jug after this encounter with Christ. And she goes off, and she goes into the town, speaking to the very people she was trying to avoid, to tell them about this man who told her everything about herself. And she is considered to be one of the first evangelists. So what I'm saying is that our Lord, again, this whole idea of mercy, this whole year of mercy that we're in, it's not about hitting people over the head with the catechism. As I said in the beginning, I'm a fine one to talk right with the life. I'll never run for office, trust me. They start at Central Michigan University with happy hour on Friday. I'm in big trouble, let me tell you. But it is truth. We have to have truth with that mercy. And so we accompany people, but we can't help them if we don't give them the truth. And so this is a huge area in terms of the life issues and sexuality and gender that's not being exposed in terms of what, again, not a religious think tank or a Republican think tank or a super duper conservative whatever. This is information research that has been done by people who are experts in this field of psychology. And this big report that came out from the New Atlantis is actually being fought now by particular activist groups. The report, and I'm reading right from the report, represents a careful summary and up-to-date explanation of research from the biological, psychological, and social sciences related to sexual orientation and gender identity. It is offered in the hope that such an exposition can contribute to the capacity as physicians, scientists, and citizens to address health issues faced by the LGBT community. So they want to offer this information to help. And it was completely ignored, for the most part, by the secular press. And now, the particular group, the doctors who did these studies, are being attacked by particular activist groups. Among other things, it said the understanding of sexual orientation as an innate biological fixed property of human beings, the idea that people are born that way, is not supported by scientific evidence. While there is evidence that biological factors such as genes and hormones are associated with sexual behaviors and attractions, there are no compelling casual biological explanations for human sexual orientation. They also had some very alarming studies about what happens to those who choose particular lifestyles. Compared to heterosexuals, non-heterosexuals are about 2 to 3 times as likely to have experienced child sexual abuse. Compared to general population, the scientists and researchers said non-heterosexual subpopulations are an elevated risk for a variety of adverse health and mental outcomes, health outcomes. Members of the non-heterosexual population are estimated to have about 1.5 times higher risk of experiencing anxiety disorders than members of the heterosexual population. And the same groups are also at a much higher risk of suicide. So this is science, this is research. And again, it's ignored or it's rejected, and now it's being protested. Mercy is not mercy if it doesn't have truth. We're not being merciful to someone if we're not being truthful. For example, God forbid if you had someone who was addicted to pornography, you would tell them, right? It causes, wreaks havoc in families, by the way. Pornography is a huge problem. You would tell them, I love you, but this is an issue and we need to get it addressed because it's causing problems. You wouldn't leave them in that. Same, Jesus didn't leave people there. He loved them right where they were at, but he didn't leave them there. He moved them out of that sin. Our Holy Father has addressed this issue of gender ideology quite frequently, and the media love him when he talks about the things that they like, such as the environment, but then they ignore him or they attack him when he talks about the truth in church teaching. And he's been speaking a lot about this issue of gender ideology. He brought it up again at World Youth Day earlier this year, and this is a quote from this summer. Today, children are told at school that they can choose their sex. Why are they taught this? Because the books are supplied by the people and institutions that give you the money. These are the ideological colonizations backed also by countries that wield a great deal of influence, and this is terrible. This is the Holy Father talking about this. All right, so I've given you a lot of information already. Now, in addition to everything I've told you, so we have the news media twisting stories, not being completely honest, in some cases, such as Under the Gun, total media manipulation, complete fabrication. I told you about the story of my friend at the major newspaper. And by the way, I have a whole interview with this person in my new book, Beyond Me, Myself, and I. So all of this going on. Now that's just, for example, the news media end of it. Then you combine all the other research that's out there in terms of how we have cultural conditioning, all right? Mention news media bias, and then there's this over-sexualized culture that we're in with the internet, pornography, advertising, music, Hollywood. Just a few statistics, and I don't want to roll you over with too many numbers, but just so you can get a perspective. College students spend between 8 to 10 hours a day on their cell phones. 8 to 10 hours a day on their cell phones. Sexting, which if you're not familiar with that term, that is taking a very suggestive picture of oneself and then texting it to someone else, is now tied to an increase in teen sexual behavior, with sexting now considered, according to the Journal of Pediatrics, normal behavior, which is insane. When the book 50 Shades of Grey first came out, there was a big push for people to go and buy that and read it, which was, I did a whole thing on my show for about 2 or 3 weeks and before the movie came out as well, trying to get women to understand how they were being objectified horribly through pornography. One Baptist counselor emailed me and said that she uses it with her couples who are in marriage counseling, and I said, okay, I'm not even gonna go there with you because that's just insane. Anyway, studies came out showing that reading 50 Shades of Grey was linked to unhealthy behavior among women, and that women who read the mommy porn books are at an increased risk of having multiple sex partners, eating disorders, and getting involved in binge drinking and other things. 34% of church-going women now say they have intentionally visited porn sites. A new national survey on porn shows Christian men have a high level of porn addiction. More than 70%, it's probably higher now, probably about 80%. That statistic is about 5 years old, but more than 80% of TV programming contains sexual content. If you have children, they will see at least 100,000 violent acts on TV each year, just on broadcast TV. I'm not talking about cable, I'm not talking about the internet, I'm not talking about cell phone. That doubles to 200,000 violent acts by the time they're 18 years old. Your kids will see on TV alone, broadcast TV alone, 14,000 sexual messages a year. About 80% of the videos on MTV contain sexual imagery. 2.5 billion emails per day are pornographic in content. 25% of all search engine requests are porn-related. And these numbers, I try to keep up on them, but they change all the time. But just think about that. 2.5 billion emails per day are pornographic in content. So you see, on every which way, shape, or form, we are being bombarded 24/7. And sometimes we can't even help it. Sometimes we just walk into, you know, a mall or at the airport or in my husband's office building in downtown Detroit, they actually have TVs on the elevators, for crying out loud. Sometimes we go online and innocently bump into something because of the way the pornographers are so expert at targeting different people. So sometimes it's you know, by no fault of our own, but we're exposed to this all the time. So that's why it's so important to be able to step back and discern this and say, okay, what's happening here? Am I being desensitized, and am I being conditioned, or have I been conditioned? Because I sure as heck was for many years. And again, it almost cost me everything. The wonderful evangelist Matthew Kelly says the way we see the world is the way we live our lives. So in other words, if we're constantly just getting, and I'm not saying that you are, because obviously you're in touch with your church because you came here tonight, but a lot of people are not in church or getting any information other than from secular sources. And I'm just really skimming the surface here, brothers and sisters, in terms of the amount of research there is to show the problems associated with that when that happens. So if all we're getting is all this negativity that is against our faith, especially the core teachings of our faith, then we are going to think that that is reality. And I've tried to present a case for you that a lot of what we're seeing is not reality tonight from the media, but it will affect the way we live our lives, or maybe even the way we vote. Jim Morrison, the famous Doors musical group, said, "Whoever controls the media controls the mind." Briefly, I just want to talk about the conscience. It's something that we've heard since we were growing up, especially as Catholics. But what's really important is to understand what the conscience is. It's not just our opinion. And there was a very interesting poll that came out earlier this year from the Pew Forum for people in the press, looking at Catholics and how they incorporate their conscience into their thinking and into their activities. And you can see this quote here: about 3/4 of U.S. Catholics say they look to their own conscience a great deal for guidance on difficult moral questions. Far fewer Catholics say they rely a great deal on the Catholic Church's teachings, the Bible, or the Pope for such guidance. Now, the scary thing is that those last 3 points, the Church's teachings, the Bible, even the Pope, because he's the head of the Church, along with the Holy Spirit, those are the sources that we're supposed to be consulting when we are forming our conscience. We have to form our conscience, the light of Scripture, intercession of the Holy Spirit, the advice of others, and guided by the authoritative teachings of the Church. Wonderful teacher Archbishop Chaput says, if we are coming to conclusions that are radically different than what the Church teaches, it's probably not the Church that's wrong. It's probably us. You can find out more about the conscience and formation of conscience in paragraphs 1783 through 1785 of the Catechism of the Catholic Church. I just want to mention an interesting email I got the other day and how I was able, thanks be to God, to have a great dialogue with this woman, and she admitted that she hadn't studied anything and she was just making decisions based on her opinion. So she writes me, and she was very nice. And she says, I heard your show with Father Mitch Pacwa from EW10, and Father and I were doing a promo for a webinar he was having on voting, and he was encouraging listeners to remove emotion and feelings and to vote, according to what the Church teaches and what we have to look at, party platforms, church teaching, blah, 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 other issues, right? But we need to remove emotion and feelings. So she writes me and says she agrees that this is a crazy election. The dirtiest, ugliest election we've ever seen, pretty much, in our lifetime. But she disagrees that we have to remove emotions and feelings. And she goes on to say how she's pro-life, even though her definition of pro-life did not come anywhere near what the Church teaches about the definition of pro-life. She says, I don't believe that this particular candidate is pro-life. I don't believe he's pro-life, never said why. And I'm doing this, and I'm in good conscience, fine with my decisions. God bless you. And so I challenged her, I went back and I said, the only source you mentioned was a little tug by the Holy Spirit to write me. That's the only time you mentioned anything about God being involved in your decisions. Where's your attribution? How do you know this candidate is not pro-life? What are you basing it on? And if you're saying that you're in good conscience, so you never mentioned the steps that you took, you never mentioned reading, faithful citizenship, living the gospel of life, the Catechism of the Catholic Church, you never even quoted Scripture. All I heard from you was, I think, I feel, I think, I feel. I said, that's not going to fly with God. And you're writing me, I'm a Catholic talk show host, if you don't want to hear what I have to say, don't write me. That was very nice about it. And I said, I'm really going to challenge you. So I gave her a whole list of reasons. I was nice. I really was. I wrote the first email, and then I threw it out. I gave her a whole list of resources, and I said, there are steps that we have to follow. And unfortunately, you haven't told me. Maybe you are, but I see nothing in here to indicate that you've made an educated decision. You've never even mentioned any news articles you've read that give you this opinion. And so, bless her heart, she wrote me back and said, you know what? You're right. I never did any of those things. And she ended up spending the whole evening looking at all the sources, and she said, I got to do a better job. So at least she was honest with me. But I see this over and over and over again, where people say, I think, I feel, and then when I push back a little bit, and then on the other hand, like she said she wasn't even going to even vote. We can't do that. We have to be responsible, we have to be involved. And again, I've got lots of resources that can help you with that, but we can't just say, I think, I feel. It's not just about us, and that's why I wrote this book, Beyond Me, Myself, and I, because we, you know, think we are all that in a bag of chips, and the world revolves around us. And I did it for years, so I'm speaking from personal experience. But I keep hearing over and over again from people saying, well, I don't feel this, or I don't feel that. This is not about our feelings. This is about being a Catholic involved in the public square. And Catholics should be involved in politics. And outside of telling you for whom to vote, we need to talk about politics in church because it's how we affect the public good. Every single thing we do in our lives has some political ramification, whether it's feeding the poor, there's legislation for that. Whether it's the environment, there's legislation for that. And of course, the bigger issues such as abortion or the issues of healthcare, if we're not expecting the church to give us some guidance, what are we coming for? Bingo and coffee and donuts? I mean, seriously. The church is supposed to teach. And folks like Father and my husband are held at a much higher authority, and if they don't teach, they're going to be held accountable. Now, there's beautiful ways to teach. Again, you don't hit people over the head with the catechism, but people need to know the truth, and you need to push back, and you need to be challenged. I was challenged a lot. And oh boy, I was stubborn. You remember, half calibres, that's tough, really thick-headed. Took me a while to come around. Took me a while. But then I finally realized, well, you know what? You're God, I'm not. I think I'll give you a little credit. You probably know a little bit more than I do. All right, our Holy Father really wants to encourage parents to get involved and reminds us that the parents are the primary educators of the children. And he addresses media issues a lot, including in his latest apostolic exhortation, Amoris Laetitia, or The Joy of Love. And he says, in many cases, parents come home exhausted, not wanting to talk, and many families no longer even share a common meal. Distractions abound, including an addiction to television. Very, very, very important point. All right, wrapping up. Our action plan. Remember, our faith is the factor, not just a factor in everything we do. A couple of years ago, we had a wonderful associate pastor at our parish that was giving a talk during the election and was saying, and he made everybody like sit up and take notice. He said, your Catholic faith should not be a factor when you're going to the voting booth. And everybody went, what is he talking about? What ever could Father mean? And then he was silent, and he said, your faith, your relationship with Christ should be the factor, not only when you go in the voting booth, but every single day. Because if we say that we love Christ, if we say that we are in relationship with him, then we are to love him with our whole mind, heart, and strength. I was really a lukewarm Christian for many, many years until I asked God to come back into my life. And there were a lot of wonderful things that happened to me. God gave me a whole new career, a whole new ministry, still on the air, but in a much different way. But he also showed me some ugly things about myself. And that wasn't easy. So I understand people who struggle. Been there, done that, bought the t-shirt. But when you surrender to God, it's amazing what happens because he loves us so much. His plan is always going to be the best plan for our lives. I've never been happier. I'm not making near the money I was when I was an anchor woman or a reporter in a major market, but I am having so much fun. And I just love, love, love talking about Jesus and the beauty of the church. So our faith is everything. It should be the main factor in our lives. Otherwise, we're just compartmentalizing. You know, and we got to go beyond Sunday. My next book coming out in February is called Beyond Sunday, Becoming a 24/7 Catholic. Consider the source or sources. Hopefully, I've given you at least a thumbnail sketch of why it's so important to be really, really careful when listening to the media. take language along with media influence very seriously. This is big stuff, and the church teaches about this a lot in terms of, as you know, Pope Francis just said, he's very worried about seeing so many parents exhausted and not really helping their kids make these important media decisions. Take language along with media influence very seriously. Seek out Catholic and other Christian media outlets. If you go to my website, and my business cards are out there, I have all kinds of resources for you. My books, I have resources in the back. Educate, educate, educate. That was a quote of the wonderful catechist Father John Hardin, who served out his last years in the Archdiocese of Detroit. We have to constantly educate ourselves on the faith and make sure we're making wise decisions. So we do this with everything else. I did it with everything else, you know, finding the perfect home, finding the perfect pair of shoes, you know, the best diet, the best restaurant, spending hours trying to figure out where I was going on vacation. And yet, when I got back into my faith, I realized, wow, I wasn't spending any time with God. And once I started to crack open the teachings of the church, especially John Paul II on his teachings on women, I was hooked. It was like I was addicted to the faith. When I discovered different shows like Catholic Answers Live, when they were defending the faith from Scripture, it was just so amazing to me. I read and I had this hunger. We are sitting on, Dr. Scott Hahn says, Catholics are sitting on Fort Knox and they don't even know it. We really are. If you look at what the church has given the world in terms of education, in terms of the hospital systems, in terms of art, in terms of the saints, in terms of knowledge, psychology, philosophy, you know, the Aquinas, the Augustines, it is incredible. And I didn't know half of it until I was in my 30s. And I wish I didn't have to sleep because I could be doing something else, such as reading. Okay? So educate ourselves and engage the media. Don't be afraid to engage the media. What do I mean by that? Well, I'm really glad that these people email me. They're engaging. And most of what's great about Catholic listeners is that they are polite. Thanks be to God. There are lots of people on my Facebook page who are not. All right. But it's really important. Engage the media. Write a letter. Send an email now is very effective. And so what do I mean by engaging them? If you hear something you like on the radio or TV, let them know, as well as something you don't like. It's a tough, tough business. It really is, media in general. And so they do react positively. And just be nice when you call them. And if you want to discuss something with them, just be polite, because it goes a lot farther, okay? You get a lot more flies with honey than you do with vinegar. Also give them feedback in terms of advertising dollars. If you see a particular company that is sponsoring something that is very offensive, or maybe attacks the Catholic Church, let the company know. Write them a letter or an email. You can write a letter to the editor. 250 words, 250 to 300 is a good length. People say, well, I'd like to write a letter, but they won't publish it. You know what I say? So what? Somebody has to read that letter. And your letter may be the only words of truth that particular newspaper editor has seen about a particular issue, especially about Catholic teaching. Commenting on articles online, respectfully, of course. Utilizing social media, e-blasts, newsletters, Twitter. Write articles in your parish bulletin. You know, we all expect the priest to do everything. Being married to a deacon, they are split in so many different ways. They need your help. I mean, we have a pro-life committee that put this event on tonight and worked very hard on it, okay? It's not just up to our church leaders, which I always thought, well, it's father's, you know, responsibility or bishop's responsibility. They do that stuff, not me, all right? Boy, was I wrong, all right? Take part in talk shows, even if they're talk shows you can't stand listening to. Call in and make a comment. Again, your little nugget of information may be the only truth that person hears. And then if you can, because we have Catholic media in this area, Mother Angelica always said, keep us between your gas and electric bills. Catholic radio subsists totally on support from listeners, because we don't want to be beholden to advertisers. So if you have Catholic radio in your area, such as The Rock or Living Bread, if you're from Canton, or if you're from the Cleveland area, support local Catholic radio. All right? And last but not least, beautiful quote from Benedict. The power of transformation is available to us. Let our lives be one whole movement toward it. Let's seek the things that are above. And be encouraged, brothers and sisters. I've given you a lot of information tonight, a lot of information about the darkness of the world. But you know what? The light has overcome the darkness, and the light is Jesus Christ. If someone like me, a wretch like me, who had a broken marriage, who was extremely secular, who was living only for herself, this is just crazy that I'm doing this. Even thinking about it on the way here, getting very emotional. You know, I'm Italian. My husband says I cry at mall openings. I get that. You know, I'm very emotional. But thinking about the work that God has done and continues to do in my life and my marriage, it's so beyond anything that I ever expected. But there's a lot of good that's going on. Every single day I interview people who have wonderful ministries within the Catholic Church. 2 weeks ago I spoke at the Catholic Leadership Conference in Denver, Colorado, with people from all over the world that have apostolates, that are working with the poor, that are working with students in college, such as FOCUS, Fellowship of Catholic University Students, or Casting Nets, which is a ministry within the church to evangelize, the new evangelization, which John Paul II and Benedict always spoke about, and now Pope Francis. So many beautiful efforts of people on the ground making a difference. And the Catholic Church is very much alive, despite what the world wants us to think. So I thank you for staying here tonight and listening to this crazy Italian from the east side of Detroit talk about my love for Jesus, my love for the church, and my love for the truth. I hope it's helpful. Pray for me as I'm out there every day on the airwaves, 2 hours a day, and going around the country trying to speak the truth in love. And know, as Jesus says, that he is always with us till the end of the age. And never forget, we win in the end. Amen. Thank you. God bless you.